This is a programme about manners. Yes, Christmas really is over. It's the first week of January and you're listening to a programme about manners. Maybe it's part of your New Year's resolutions. You're going to listen to more improving things about rules you need to keep. Maybe you've experienced a lot of bad manners over Christmas. People certainly get drunk and rude and say inappropriate things at office parties or after lunch on Christmas Day when the red wine and resentment start to mingle. Most people know what's meant by the word manners. Please and thank you, not talking with your mouth full, offering your seat to the fat lady on the bus who you thought was pregnant while avoiding asking, when's it due? But where do these manners come from? Are they important? And are they in decline as we lose the Victorian obsession with dress codes and cutlery conventions? Or as deeply ingrained in our society as ever? This programme will address all of those questions and more. Well, not more, just those. We've only got four episodes. And people do worry about the state of manners. Take Tony, the butcher at Newport Indoor Market. When a young lad rode his bike through the market the other day, Tony was furious. He told the boy to get off his bike, which he did, but that wasn't the end of it.
And he came back to me about 5 minutes later, and he said, listen, you, there's no signs here saying I can't ride my bike. I said, not a sign of Max and Spencer's either, mate. You got any bloody common sense or what? I can't believe what we've bred in this country. Manners have seemed to have disappeared.
And here's Obby, who lives in Hackney. This is worse, it's her friends who are being rude.
When you go out, they're on their phone. I mean, why don't you just do that at home? Or do it when we're finished? If you know you're going to be continuously on your phone, yeah. Don't bother, come out. Don't bother, come out.
Tony's had enough. Obby's had enough, and the media only feed this sense of disappointment. In the Daily Telegraph, I read that lunch with the younger generation is like feeding time at the zoo. In The Guardian, there's a sad story about people shouting scrounger at someone disabled on a mobility scooter. And on Victoria Derbyshire's TV show, a famous singer confronts an online troll who's been threatening to rape women. The troll wasn't named, of course. They never are. We're building up a bit of a gloomy picture of a civilization falling to bits. Is that the stage we're at? The bit when the Romans started to hurl excrement at each other rather than build great statues? Well, I'm not so sure. I'm not prepared to be that gloomy in the first week of the year. I think it would be irresponsible broadcasting and positively impolite. So in these four programmes, I'm going to work out whether things really are as gloomy as Tony and others believe, or whether there's some cause for hope. Or whether a future of relentless rudeness might not be that bad after all. Manners, to my mind at least, are about learning to interact civilly with other people. Not family, you can't be expected to be civil to them. But the first time you meet a large number of strangers and have to be nice to them, no matter what you think, is at school. That's where the civilising process really begins. Four-year-olds arrive unable to hold a knife and fork, and one term later they're having lunch together, putting food safely into their mouths, not waving forks around, other than in the credits of Grange Hill in the 1980s. A teacher in a reception class is an early manners guru, a key figure in civilising future society. Zoe Barber at St Mary Magdalene Primary School in North London is just such a person.
My children at the moment are trying to grasp the idea that when I'm talking to one person, I can't actually talk to six other children at the same time.
Right. Part of it is fully understanding that there are other people.
Yes, definitely. At the moment, the world revolves around them and them only. And I will say, just wait a minute, I'm just speaking to so-and-so. And 2 seconds later, they'll be tugging on my sleeve.
Because they've already waited what felt like an age.
Yes, or I have them come up to me and shake me from behind. And say, just need to wait your turn. I will be with you in a minute. Just hold on. And they do get better throughout the year, but at the beginning, it is quite challenging with 30 children, trying to get them to understand that there are 29 other children. It's not just them.
So are we all born megalomaniacs?
Very egocentric, but that's normal, isn't it? It's just the way they are.
Zoe is instilling in children a mutually understood code of behaviour that's taken centuries to develop. There's a book about it, The Civilising Process, by a German sociologist called Norbert Elias. In the history of manners, you need to know about Norbert Elias. He's the most important thinker you've never heard of, according to Steven Pinker, the professor of psychology from Harvard University, and a thinker you probably have heard of. After all, you are listening to Radio 4.
Hi, how are you?
Fine, thank you.
Thanks very much for talking to us today.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Not at all.
It was a short interview, but nothing if not polite.
A couple of words, how's this?
Great. I think we can start.
So let's hear about Norbert Elias, a German Jew who published his great tome, The Civilizing Process, in 1939, a point where the civilizing process was under considerable threat. It charted the centuries of changing habits in human patterns of behaviour, from farting to murder. We couldn't get an interview with Norbert Elias because he died in 1990, but Steven Pinker was happy to talk about the great man.
He's one of the grand theoreticians about the course of history, in particular the transition to modernity that took place in Europe over a span of several centuries, beginning, say, in the 13th century. And he noted that there was a transition that was urged on people by etiquette manuals, including one by Erasmus, of all people. We think of him as a great social philosopher. Mm-hmm. But he was also concerned with table manners.
Right.
And advisories that we take for granted, like wait till everyone is served before you start to eat, don't slurp from the bowl, don't wipe your fingers on your shirt, don't gnaw on a bone and then put it back in the serving dish. Dozens of advisories that we give to four-year-olds had to be instilled on adult Europeans.
What are the most important things in table?
Please and thank you, and don't chew with your mouthful.
Why do you think we shouldn't chew with our mouthful?
Because it's rude, and sometimes it can just put people off their food.
Zoe Barber's four-year-olds, who arrive at school as skirt-tugging megalomaniacs, will leave with a whole load of rules in their heads, which they may or may not stick to as teenagers.
When we have big family dinners like roast dinner, I hate it when people want something and just lean right over you to get to it. And I find it really rude because they're like almost touching your food.
I sat down for lunch with Elizabeth, Teddy, Oshan, Grace, Kale and Ruel, all in their last year at St Mary Magdalene Primary. And it was very civilised.
What other things do you get told not to do at the table?
Don't put your elbows on the table. I don't exactly know why that's one, but that's just a common one most of the time.
Yeah, that's it, because you just had your elbows on the table. And just in the when he said, don't put your elbows on the table, you just suddenly, oh, whoops, I've got my elbows on the table. Yes, that is a common one, isn't it?
That's exactly what my dad says. He's always saying, get your elbows off the table.
And what do you think the reason for elbows on the table is?
Yeah. It's because there's not enough room for you to put your elbows on the table and other people to sit there. So say if like you had someone next to you who put their elbows on the table, but you also put your elbows on the table.
That's the best justification for the elbows on the table rule I've ever heard. Throughout my childhood, my dad was always telling me, elbow, get your elbows off the table, elbows, elbows. But that's the reason for it, isn't it?
I always get told to make nice conversation with everyone when we're eating. Otherwise, it's just kind of awkward sometimes when you're just sitting there eating and no one's talking.
Oh, really? What's your best technique for keeping the conversation going?
Well, I normally, my best conversation starter is, how was your day? And it works very well.
By the way, if Oshan sounds a bit muffled, it's because he's covering his mouth to conceal the fact that he's talking with his mouth full. He's obviously finding the whole doing a radio interview while eating a bit of an etiquette minefield, as well he might. This is centuries of manners evolution. And they don't just know the rules, they know it can be good manners to ignore bad manners, and also that different countries have different manners. Elizabeth's family are German.
This is probably not for most people, but at home I always have to have my hands on the table because it's sort of a cultural thing in Germany. They had it long ago because if you had your hands off the table and underneath the table, then you could be hiding a weapon. So that's why it's a cultural thing to have your hands on the table. So I always forget to have my hands on the table because it's different in school.
Sometimes if people are having bad manners around them, sometimes they might not purposely mean that. So sometimes you have to take a chance and forgive them because they might not be doing it just to get on your nerves. It kind of is one of the manners to forgive somebody as a manner.
But the story of manners, as told by Norbert Elias, went way beyond table manners. He said that over the centuries and a whole range of behaviour, there was a gradual hardwiring of self-restraint in our brains. We learned self-control. And if Elias's theory is good enough for Professor Pinker, it's good enough for me. Here he is again.
Impulsive violence seemed to be part of everyday life in the Middle Ages, that there would be friends laughing after a meal in a pub, and then there'd be an insult and someone would pull out a knife and you'd have a body on the floor. There was also a lack of what we would today consider norms of sexual propriety. having.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.